Okay. Thank you very much for introduction. So I will. Is that okay? Okay. So I will talk about some exact results in supersymmetric gauge theory, and maybe you already know many of these. But I suppose you don't know almost anything about this result. So if you know it, I'm sorry for that. Anyway, so first I will talk about four-dimensional supersymmetric gauge theory on flat space. In a flat space, localization techniques cannot use, or yeah, we can use it, but it's not so useful. And the other technique called holomorphy of the superfield is used for that, and we can have many interesting results. And this is the basic for the supersymmetric gauge theories and exact result to obtain. From supersymmetric gauge theories. And I will talk about N equal 1 supersymmetric QCD, Seebeck duality, etc., and N equal 2 Seebeck-Witten theories. Then I will move to the index and the localization techniques. And index or localization techniques can be used for the supersymmetric gauge theory on a curved compact manifold. Okay. So this is actually alternative from this one. Actually, localization can cover this flat space case also, but it's very complicated and very technical, and I do not recommend this localization technique to use this one. But anyway, yeah, we can use localization, but localization is very useful technique to get exact result in gauge theories. So I will introduce such localization and also index. Index is these two are almost same one. So I will talk about these topics. And actually, the actual localization computation is very technical and very complicated. So, sorry. Sorry. Ah, okay. Okay. Oh, this is okay. Not a earphone. Sorry. 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 Thank you very much. Okay. And so I will introduce a very simple example, which is just a toy model. But I think we will understand what's localization technique and the index in general. And then I will move to the 3D N equal 2 supersymmetric quantum field theorem S3. S3 is probably the simplest one, very interesting things. And we can analyze this theory in a large N limit, and then we can check, we can compare with it with the IDCFT something, and we will see exact matching, and it's very interesting. And then I will probably talk about some other topics after that. Okay. So, okay. Ooh. So first, I will review for the supersymmetric gauge theories on R4 or R1 comma 3. So I assume you already read a Weisbacher's book or something, but. To fix a notation or to remember what's one beta naught PM. So I will review. Okay, this is a four-dimensional supersymmetric algebra. This is called n equal 1 supersymmetric algebra. This includes one wire spinner. Okay. And this is a wire spinner index, and this is a translation generator. And, I'll explain what the sigma here, but anyway. So, Suji algebra contains, this means this Suji algebra is a fermionic generator. Here I will introduce F minus 1 F as something fermion number. This is a fermion number generator. But this F is not needed to be defined, but we need this minus 1 to F. This should be defined. Okay. And spinner convention is okay, this is my spinner convention. This is the same as Westbacher's book. Okay, can you read it? Okay. And. Mm. Okay, here in Lorentz signature, okay, so it's not a Euclidean, but then this psi bar or chi bar means element conjugate of chi, or complex conjugate of chi. But this sigma bar is not a complex conjugate of sigma. This is defined by this matrices. Okay, this is not a element conjugate of this one, but here these are element conjugate in Lorentzian signature. Okay, and Dirac spinner is defined by this using two wire spinners, and Majorana spinner is defined by this from one wire spinner. Okay, like these in a Dirac spinner notation. So one Majorana spinner is same as one wire spinner, and then there is a real four spinners in Dirac, I mean this convention. I mean, so this Q alpha contains four real components. Okay, so this theory is this 4DN equal one gauge theory is called four Suji theories. Okay, this notation is very confusing, but this notation is more transparent. There is four independent real components for supersymmetry generators. Okay, and then okay, so free. Okay, so this is just a Okay, so this is a free Dirac spinner action in a wire notation, and we will use this compact notation. This is as usual, and okay. So this means, for example, psi chi equal chi psi. Because these psi and chi are Fermionic variable, so it's anti-commute. Then this is anti-symmetric. This epsilon is anti-symmetric, so we found this one. Okay. Then this is a Dirac spinner. Use a Dirac spinner action, but actually this, okay, if there is a no mass term, massless case, we can define the action only using one wire spin. So free wire spinner in our notation is like, this. Here we introduce Majorana mass. Replacing psi bar and psi as chi bar and chi. Then we have wire spinner action. Okay. Okay, so this is our notation for the spinners in this lecture, for the n equal 1 case. And then, so if we consider a free massless complex scalar, this one, just a Klein-Gordon equation, and a free massless wire spin here, then this is supersymmetric. Actually, if we introduce this supersymmetric transformation, then delta xi, for example, phi bar, Okay. So under this transformation, this L0 transforms like this one. Total divergence can be seen from these equations. This is just a definition of a 3D transformation, and acting this 3D transformation on this five bar, then we have this one. And acting 3D transformation on this psi, then we have this one. Inserting this psi with I. This one into here, then we have this one. And using commutation relation or anti-commutation relation of this sigma, we have this one. You can check from the definition of sigma m and n. Okay. Then these two canceled. And here we introduce this xi as a Feynmanic field. So this delta xi is a bosonic transformation. It's commute with Feynmanic variables, okay? So you can check that, this one. Acting on this phi and acting on this phi bar to this delta xi is a Hermitian conjugate of this one. So we have this one. Okay. But because of this delta m or Laplacian, we have this total divergence term here. Okay. Then, of course, then this is Lagrangian, so action is of course invariant under this 3D transformation because of the integration over the R4. So, this means supersymmetric field theory. Supersymmetric field theory is not special. Actually, free massless scalar plus Wahl spinner is supersymmetric. Okay. And then, okay. And we can construct a generator of Q and Q bar from this supersymmetric transformation by native. Current, okay, as a user. And now we are at mass term with the same mass for the complex scalar and the Wahl spinner. Then, with this same transformation, then this under this supersymmetric transformation, this LM, this Lagrangian transforms like this one. This is the Hermitian conjugate of this one. And then sigma n plus sigma n psi bar m y plus Okay, then this can be so this is same as this one. Here, this is a Hermitian conjugate, this is a total divergence, and this is a term vanishing under the equation of motion. Equation of motion for this combined Lagrangian is, of course, a Klein-Gordon equation and Dirac equation for biased. Okay. So then, the action is invariant under the equation of motion. Then we can construct a neta charge for this supersymmetric transformation. Actually, maybe you don't know. Sorry. Sorry, could you speak? Invariant, this action. Are you? Are you okay for this expression, or this expression is okay? Okay. Ah, sorry. In the invariant under E O M equal zero. So actually, action is not invariant. If we impose this equation motion, then action is invariant. Okay. So this term is of course vanishing, because the action is integration over the, this is total divergence. And this term is proportional to this equation motion. Equal to, sorry, in front of? This one? No, plus. Sorry. So this, transformation of this one is this one plus total divergence plus terms proportional to equation motion. Okay? Okay, of course, we can use a complex conjugate of this one and this one, of course. Listen. Okay. Okay. Sorry. You are right. Sorry. Oh, sorry. Or more precisely, sorry. Equal delta m star plus e o m. Sorry. Okay. No. sorry. Okay, using this one. This comes from these terms, and this comes, so these terms comes from this term. No, 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 no. Sorry, using this equation motion, sorry. Okay, I already massaging these terms. Okay, using these terms and using this equation motion. Okay, so this term is like m squared phi. Okay, this phi. Like this equation motion for the this. For this total Lagrange, sorry. So here we need this condition. Supersymmetric algebra becomes minus 2i. So then you can check that Suji algebra, I mean, is proportional to this one. This is a correct one, and here x is any function of phi psi phi up psi. Yeah, this is a yeah. This is actually a derivation, so we can check this one for phi phi bar and psi bar. Then any function for any function, we can check that one. But because of this EOM here, this closure of the Suji algebra, we need equation motion equals zero condition. Okay, but anyway, with this equation motion, Suji algebra is consistent with Cuba equal to Xi sigma m eta bar. This. Okay, so this this formalism is called on shell. On shell formalism. Yes. So in this formalism, the invariance of the action and the closure of the Suzy algebra is under the equation of motion. So this is called imposing equation of motion equals zero is a on shell condition. So this is called on shell formalism. But it's not convenient because we need to impose on shell condition everywhere. Okay, so this is not convenient. So, so introducing the auxiliary field. Okay. But actually, if some supergravity theory is some n equal 2 or n equal 4 supersymmetric something, then in some theories, we need this on shell formalism. So this introduction of the auxiliary fields is not a trivial thing. For this simple case, for the n equal 1 case, we can do that. But okay, anyway, off-shell. So off-shell formalism is using a supersymmetric transformation for complex scalar. This is same. So here we introduce this auxiliary complex field F, and F equal I. Okay, then then we can check that this transformation satisfies this supersymmetric algebra without this condition. Okay, this term depends on what the actual Lagrangian is. Okay, but this in the off-shell formalism, this transformation close. This is nice. And then the Lagrangian. The invariant Lagrangian becomes L0. Oh. So this is a, sorry, 数字. Invariant Lagrange. Okay. You can check this Lagrange and invariant and this 数字 transformation without imposing equation motion. Okay. And you also check that integrating out this auxiliary field from this action, we have this master. So this Lagrangian is same as on-shell actions. So real degrees of freedom for this theory is phi is a complex, so 2, and in on-shell formalism there's no f, so this psi have a real 4 component, but because of the Dirac equation or equation motion, this becomes 2. Okay, and 2 minus 2 equals 0. So same degree of freedom, of course. Actually, supersymmetry, of course, relate boson and fermion. So degree of freedom should be same. So this on-shell formalism is same. And in off-shell formalism, this is a complex scalar, and F is also a complex scalar. And psi is a fermion, but here there is no equation motion. So there's a 4 real component. So this is a 4. So 4 minus 4 equals 0. Okay. But this is not not correct, because this is a field theory. Okay, so field theory has an infinite degree of freedom. So this degree of freedom is actually 2 times infinity, because of the field is a infinite dimensional degree of freedom. So 2 times infinity minus 2 times infinity can be finite. Okay, actually this index is computing something like this finite value. The number of the difference between the degrees of freedom in the supersymmetric quantum field theory. Okay. Sorry? Finite. Sorry. Infinite. Okay. I mean just this is a field theory. Field theory. So in a quantum mechanics, it's of course an infinite degree of freedom because of, for example, by the Fourier transformation or something. Yeah. Actually, even in a quantum mechanics, actually the state is infinite. Okay, so actually even in a quantum mechanics, this infinity appears, and even in a quantum mechanics, this can be non-zero and finite value. So this is called sometimes index, and this is related to part 2. So here, you can forget about that. But this is a naive counting of degree of freedom. This should be matched, of course. Okay. Right. Actually, I will explain later, but using a super algebra for the matched state, we can explicitly construct some pairs of the Fermi state and the Boson state. then it's canceled. But for the massless mode, or the vacuum state, then we cannot construct such a pairing. So, sorry, I do not understand. This, yeah, naive counting, this two is just a naive counting of the mode of this one. So, I mean, okay, this two is something like, for example, if we consider quantum mechanics, this two just means that there is a two-dimensional quantum mechanics or something like that. Okay. Then there is an infinite state for every degree of freedom. And then a massive state or excited state, we can check this degree of freedom and this degree of freedom are canceled. But for the vacuum state, we cannot show such things. And then we have this finite value. Okay. So for this is, for example, if this is a harmonic oscillator, then this two means 0, 1, everything plus this a equal 1, 2, or something, da 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 da. And these things are canceled between this one and this one. But this 0 cannot cancel because need not to be canceled. And then we have some difference between the degree of freedom. Okay. So I will explain later. So this is here we forget about this one. And this is just if this is different, then there's no, of course, supersymmetry. Okay. Okay. Yeah, here. Okay. So this is okay. But to construct an interacting supersymmetric field theory, it's very difficult. Yeah, okay. So we can do that by try and error, but it's very complicated. And for example, for the supergravity case, we need to do that. But in general, there is some convenient way to construct an interacting supersymmetric field theory. Okay. So to do that, we need to introduce a superspace and a superfield. Okay. Actually, this is a so I will explain about the superfield. Before that, I will comment on something related to this. Actually, this on-shell formalism is the most general. If we have a superfield, then we can construct an off-shell action by using a component field. I will explain about that. I think you know that, but anyway. And if there is an off-shell field, then we have an on-shell field, on-shell formalism, by integrating as an object field. Okay. So this on-shell formalism is most general. Most general means. If we have a superfield formalism, then we have an on-shell action. on-shell formalism, theory in on-shell formalism. But if we have a, even if we have a on-shell, theory in on-shell formalism, then, sometimes we do not, we cannot construct a off-shell formalism or superfield formalism. Right.
So it's less general?
Less general. Yes. Yes. Superfield. Off-shell. On-shell. But this is a more, in some sense, more useful or more convenient. Okay. And and actually, in our own shell, to do the localization computation, we need this off-shell formalism. For the localization technique. And if we have a super field, then we can use the technique of the holomorphy. This is part one, this is part two, okay? So this is, So if we have a, this superfield formalism, then we can use the holomorphy technique, and this is very useful. And maybe this, this is a bit subtle, but this is some index. So this is related to the index. Well, it's a bit, okay. Right. For example, yes. Yeah, at least in principle. Actually, I don't know. Maybe, yeah. Yes. Okay. So index is defined in operator formalism. And operator formalism is implicitly using on-shell condition. Okay, so this is related to the index. Sorry. Maybe, yeah, thank you. yeah, actually my point. なんか 昨日全然寝てないから Okay, thank you. Okay, so super fields. Okay, so let's continue the lecture. So now I will introduce the superfields, and using that I have some exact result in a supersymmetric gauge theory. Okay. Okay, here, if we want to consider the representation of a translation generator or a Poincaré algebra, then we can introduce a field phi x. Phi x is automatically representation of a translational symmetry. Okay, and then if you want to consider the representation of a super algebra. Then if you consider the representation of a super algebra, then we can introduce a super space and the fields on the super space. It's called super fields. Okay. So then this super field is automatically the representation of the super algebra. Here, of course, sorry, PM. Of course, in a super, in a user space. This momentum is represented by this derivation operator. Okay, in a super space. The superalgebra Q is also represented by the derivative. Okay, so this is a user space to this one. Then you can check that this commutation of this derivative operator is same as a super algebra. You can check that. And then infinitesimal transformation, I mean, is represented by this one. This is for user field. This PM is this derivative. Okay. This is the user. Just okay. Then. 数字トランスフォーメーション。Same as this one, okay. Okay, then the commutator of this Q, Q bar is same as super algebra. We have a representation of super algebra in a, on a super field. Actually, delta eta, delta xi minus delta xi, delta eta. Equal minus 2 xi. Xi bar, pn, phi, x, theta, theta bar. Okay. Actually, but this super is not like a user field, but theta is a fermionic variable, actually classical fermionic variable. So we can expand by theta and theta bar in this super field. Okay, so theta is a fermionic field. So if we expand this phi by theta and theta bar, then this is like a Taylor expansion of theta, theta bar, but this, there's a theta 1, theta 2, theta 1, theta 2, and theta bar 1, and theta 2. So there's a only four components. So it's terminate at this theta 1, theta 2, theta 1. Because theta 1 times theta 1 equals 0. Okay? Then, there is only this dot dot dot, but anyway, these are user field. So this super field is just an assemble of the user field. Okay, and we have this relation. Okay, so we have super representation of super algebra in these component fields. This is an ordinary field. So this is a super field. Okay, this is good. And this is good because in a user field, this Lagrangian is translationally invariant. Okay, if we integrating out this user space, then this becomes translationally invariant. Okay. And and actually the product of the superfield is again superfield. Actually, product of a field is again field. Okay, so then we can construct, okay, for example, phi, some function phi x is transition invariant. Okay, so we can construct any interacting, any action which is invariant under translation symmetry. Okay, then for the super field, there is a additional fermionic coordinate. Then, instead of a function of phi, we can construct phi x theta theta bar. K is like a Lagrangian, so we can construct the arbitrary functional of this superfield. Then this is Suji invariant. Because of this integration over the whole space, like a user field. Okay. Of course, you can check that. And of course, this is, if we integrate out of this fermionic field first, then this expansion by this theta and theta bar is terminated at somewhere. So we have some function in a component field. Okay, this is this case, theta expanding this one by theta and theta bar, and then integrate out by this theta and theta bar. Then this becomes a functional of the component field, this A, psi, psi bar, something, and B. And then this is a, or maybe we can write this as a Lagrangian. Okay, so this Lagrangian is supersymmetric invariant automatically for any functional of this A psi dot theta. Okay, so then we can construct interacting supersymmetric action using a superfield. Okay, so this is good. But so too many fields. Actually, this A theta psi bar and some gravity-like things or something, and then we need to impose some constraint. Okay, this is a representation of the superalgebra, but it's not irreducible. It's a bigger than the irreducible representation. So we need to have some smallest representation from this one. So to do that, we impose some constraint which keeps this superfield structure. Okay. So there are only two ways to find the smallest representation. One is this one. Of course, you already know anyway, chiral. Two. Okay, so there is two ways. One is trivial, this one. So we need imposing a reality condition. This is called vector superfield because it contains a gauge theory. And the other one is a chiral superfield, chiral merge plate. This is given by this condition. Here, the bar alpha dot is defined by this. And this D and D bar is a special properties. That is which anticommute is Q and Q bar. Okay. So this, okay. Is a net charge. Forget about the net charge or something. You just consider the superfield and construct this one or something like that. Then we have this one. Q is defined by Q in the superfield, superspace, defined by the formula like Q alpha equal d alpha plus like this one. Just a derivative operator in a superfield. So this Q is this one. Okay. And then. the small difference actually for Q here is a minus. Okay, like that. Okay. Okay, there's some small difference. Then we can check this one. So D is like a Q, but its anticommute is Q. So it's like a Cashmere operator in a superalgebra, something like that. So it's because D commute, anticommute with Q, that means D also commute with, of course, translation. So this constraint is consistent with the representation of the superalgebra in Q. Okay. So then we can introduce this condition on a superfield. Okay. And of course, if we do not have this condition, then this condition is inconsistent with the superalgebra, and then the action is not invariant under supersymmetric transformation. Okay. And as a net charge, here we can construct a supersymmetric gauge theory, supersymmetric field theory action. And then quantizing this one, or we can construct a net charge from this action because this action is invariant. Then we have a Q in this field, okay, as a net charge, okay. Okay, it's like PM. Yeah, this PM is also represented by the operator, like delta phi, momentum tensor. But in a space, it's also represented by this derivative. So this is like such things. Okay, now consider chiral. Chiral superfield. So now we introduce a new coordinate in superspace. Plus I theta sigma m theta bar theta bar. Okay. Okay, this is just a coordinate change for x to y. Okay, this coordinate is good because in this coordinate we find this d bar operator is just represented by this derivative. Okay. Actually, this del dx to del y m gives some extra part here. Okay, and then it cancels. No. This it's a inverse. So this transformation canceled this terms, and only we have a. This t bar. Okay. So in this coordinate, this condition is equivalent to this one, y theta bar. Then of course this in this y theta bar coordinate, because this is just a just y theta. Then in this coordinate, this is this satisfies this one. Okay. And then we can expand this one very easily, and root 2 psi alpha y theta alpha plus theta f y. Okay, there is only a theta 1 and theta 2. There is no dependence on theta bar. So it's theta expansion by theta is terminated as a this quadratic order. Okay. Why this is sorry, why? Y, yes, why? Not x. Yes. In a x coordinate, we can use this relation into this one. And then we have another term in a superfield in this user x theta bar coordinate. Okay. This one? Sorry. It's okay? Okay, sorry. The Suji transformation is like delta phi. So here, this Q and Q bar is in a superfield. In a derivative in a superfield. And then we have delta phi x equal root 2 xi phi. Okay. For example, this xi q contains a delta theta alpha, contains this derivative in theta, and then this act on this psi theta gives a xi psi, this one. Okay, then it doesn't contain the theta. So it is a, so this gives this theta, so it's a lowest component transformation of delta phi. Okay, then you find the transformation in a coordinate, component field, using this relation, okay, and then you find a delta psi delta f something. Then you see this transformation is the same as a offset formalism. Okay. And to see that, remember this is y, not x, okay? So there is some extra term in x coordinate, okay? So including that things, we have a derivative in x in this supersymmetric transformation. Here there is no derivative, but okay. Okay, and then this is the main part. Supersymmetric invariant action. Of course, this term. This term is invariant, as I said before. But there is another. So the other types of supersymmetric action using a chiral superfield. Okay. Is like this one. Okay? This is because so there is no theta bar in chiral superfield. So there's only y and theta. So integrating over this y and theta only gives a supersymmetric action. Okay? And this term is called Kähler potential. And this is called super potential. Okay, but a point is in a Kähler potential here, this is a generic term, so we can introduce phi and phi dagger. Phi dagger is also, phi is a chiral superfield. Phi dagger is not a chiral superfield, it's an anti-chiral superfield, but it's still superfield. So this is a supersymmetric invariant. But in a super potential, this chiral superfield, phi is a chiral superfield, but phi dagger is not a chiral superfield. So we cannot introduce phi dagger in this phi, this super potential. W is a function of phi only, or derivative of phi. Del phi is okay, but so no phi dagger. Phi dagger is, phi dagger. Phi dagger satisfies something like this one. This is anti-chiral superfield. So this is, including this one, this doesn't invariant and that's the action. Then so this W is a holomorphic function of phi. Okay. Yeah. For example, K can be a GZ bar something, but W should be Z square Z cube plus N. No, there's no Z bar inside. Okay. So you may think this is a small difference, but it's actually a big difference because the holomorphic function is very restricted. Actually, sometimes if we impose some boundary condition of the holomorphic function, then holomorphic function is uniquely determined. Okay, but if a user function, I mean, non-holomorphic function is infinitely many choices, but the holomorphic function with some fixed boundary condition is sometimes often unique. So then using this holomorphic property, we can have a, we can fix what is W if we can get information of the boundary condition. This is how to get exact result in supersymmetric gauge theory in a superfield. Okay, I will explain that. Okay, but this is a very important point. So maybe so let us consider the simplest example of this kind of the supersymmetry action using only a chiral superfield. It's called a Westmino model. This is not related to the Westmino condition in gauge theory, but anyway, it's called a Westmino model. This is the first four-dimensional simple supersymmetric field theory. But okay. So this is the simplest things. Actually, this Keller potential should be Hermitian. So this is the simplest simplest choice. Okay. And the W, for the W, the linear one is a bit strange, but anyway, if we start from the quadratic part, then this is a quadratic part, and this is a cubic part, and plus blah, blah, blah. But this is a for the partially normalizable theory, this is only the choice. And then, integrating out this theta and theta bar, and then we have a component in a component field Lagrangian. It's then you can check that. Okay. This one. This scalar potential gives this free field Lagrangian in off-shell theory. Okay. And this superpotential terms gives this one gives a mass term considered before. And also this term gives this one. This is a Yukawa interaction. I use plus I theta sigma m theta bar theta m by plus theta theta. Plus. Perelman part is a bit complete, but anyway, this one is like this one. And then these terms, phi times phi dagger contains this terms. This terms times complex conjugate of this one gives this term integrating this theta, theta bar or something like that. Then you can check that this one is correct. Okay, especially this one is very simple. This is a phi phi and phi cubic, so it gives also of phi, sorry, phi f, because of the, there's a theta, theta, something like that. Sorry. This is psi psi. Psi psi, because this is a holomorphic function. So there's a, there's a Hermitian conjugate for the this super potential. But for the psi bar, psi dagger psi, it's using a chiral, anti-chiral superfield. Okay, so this is a W plus Hermitian conjugate means W phi d d square theta plus d square theta bar, W bar, phi dagger, or something like that. And these terms include psi dagger psi. Psi dagger psi dagger, sorry. This Hermitian conjugate includes psi dagger phi bar. Something like that. Okay. So this is, should be psi psi. And okay. Then, so this is a Yukawa term, integrating out, integrating out auxiliary field F. F. Then we found F bar minus phi plus lambda phi square. Okay, integrating out F gives F is here in a free potential and here and here. Then integrating F gives F bar equal minus M5 times lambda phi square. This is linear in F and this is quadratic. So this is correct answer. And then potential. Proportional to V equal, I think, okay. F, here F and F bar is given by this one. So this includes the mass term, M5 phi bar, and also quotic term, including lambda, lambda bar, phi squared, phi bar squared. So this includes some interaction terms. So from this simple superfluid action, we have a interacting action. And then, okay. So this is a scalar potential for this theory. So the vacuum is defined by this one. Okay, this is a positive definite because FF bar. Okay, this is a because this FF bar is positive definite. This is a consequence of the superalgebra. But here we found this one by explicit computation. Okay, so the vacuum is a minimum of the potential. It's a V equals zero. So this is same as F equals zero. Okay, so in a supersymmetric gauge theory or supersymmetric quantum field theory, the vacuum condition is usually given by this auxiliary field equals zero condition, and this is sometimes called F. It's like this one, F equals zero or something like that. And for generic, general. If you consider the general scalar potential here, this is a standard one. It gives a user free field action. But if you consider the general scalar potential. Here introduce several color superfield labeled by I. Okay, I can be 1, 2 something, NF or something. Okay, plus plus F I F bar J plus fermion. And then this is J bar. Using this this one into this one, we have this component action. Okay, this G is a derivative of this generic potential by this one. Again, if K is just a phi dagger case and this is a similar model case, this becomes a constant, so this becomes a constant. So then this gives this part, okay? But in general, if K is a phi dagger plus phi dagger squared plus something, then the kinetic term is different here, okay? And this is something like a metric in a nonlinear sigma model. So this is a nonlinear sigma model. Actually, a kinetic term is on some manifold. Maybe it's a compact, maybe something. And then this GIGIJ bar is considered as a metric on the of the nonlinear sigma model. And this metric is called a Kähler metric. And okay, so this nonlinear sigma model is on a Kähler manifold. Kähler manifold is a complex manifold with this Kähler metric. Okay, so this is very special. Actually, we can take in a user nonlinear sigma model, we can take any metric, but here it should be complex, phi and phi bar. There's no phi or something like that, and this is phi bar. And also, this metric is given by some derivative of one function, Kähler potential. It's called Kähler manifold. So this metric is very special. Okay. So in n equal one supersymmetric field theory, and for the Kähler superfield, superpotential is holomorphic, a complex and holomorphic. It's of course very special. And Kähler potential is also special. It's a Kähler manifold. This is a consequence of the supersymmetry. Okay, so target space is Kähler. So if we consider n equal 2 or something, for n equal 2, this becomes a hyper Kähler or rigid super, special geometry or something like that. But anyway, this is a for n equal 1 case, this becomes a Kähler. So this holomorphic structure and the Kähler potential structure is generic in four Suji quantum field theory in general dimension. General dimension means in a 3D, n equal 2 or something like that. So you can introduce super potential, Kähler potential, or something like that. So it's a important notion. Yeah. Oh, for example, if you consider S4, S4 is not a complex manifold. We cannot introduce a complex coordinate in S4. So this scalar position cannot take, in a S4 or something like that. Torus is okay. Torus is okay, but S4 is not okay. So this condition is actually, this is a scalar manifold. It's more restricted. But for superpotential. So now we examine what is the consequence of the holomorphy of the superpotential. Oh, maybe I should stop here. It's 1:30 for the lunch. Sorry.